Have you ever thought why one plant can live in an area, but another one can't? Plant growth and development is first affected by the plant's genetics. However, the plant environment, which is the above and below ground surroundings of the plant, also profoundly affects the plant. In fact, genetically identical plants can exhibit a dramatically different appearance when grown under different environmental conditions. Therefore, a grower must be knowledgeable in all aspects of the plant's environment to maximize plant growth and development for high yields and quality crops. The two main areas of the plant's environment are the atmospheric environment, which is the above ground portion of the terrestrial plant's environment, and the edaphic environment, which is the soil and area where plant roots are located. Both the atmospheric and edaphic environment can be broken down into the abiotic, non-living factors, and biotic, living factors. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video, I'll focus on the plant's atmospheric environment. Climate and weather, although linked, are not the same. Weather is the combined effect of complex interactions among temperature, rainfall, wind, light, and relative humidity in a specific location. Weather factors have changing patterns on a daily, weekly, monthly, and yearly basis. The same weather pattern year after year is the climate. The sun influences atmospheric conditions, including temperature, moisture, light, and wind. These conditions, in turn, affect plant growth. Atmospheric conditions that have a profound effect on plant growth are discussed next. Abiotic factors are non-living factors such as light, temperature, air, moisture, and wind that affect the atmospheric environment. The main source of light for all plants is the sun. When discussing light, three components must be taken into consideration: light intensity, light quality, and photoperiod. Light intensity is the actual quantity of light. The highest light intensity occurs at noon. The actual amount of light reaching the plant is affected by a variety of factors such as clouds, trees, or buildings that cause shading. After the light reaches the leaf surface, it can be absorbed or reflected. So only a small amount of light is used in photosynthesis. Light intensity has a profound effect on plant growth. At high light intensities, plants are typically shorter, appear dark green, and have brittle leaves. The effects are worsened with deficiencies in nutrients. Plants grown under low light, however, are tall as a result of etiolation, which is exaggerated growth of the stem caused by low light levels. The naturally occurring plant hormone, indole 3-acetic acid, IAA, plays a key role in etiolation type growth in plants. Here are some edible tidbits. Bean sprouts and white asparagus are grown in the dark. White asparagus is actually buried so light doesn't hit the spears and green them up. Unlike asparagus, bean sprouts are covered or kept in the dark when they are planted. Light quality is the actual color or wavelength of light. Plants absorb light to be used for photosynthesis in the visible portion of the spectrum, which is between 390 and 550 nanometers. Most of the light reaching the surface of Earth is in the visible light range. In this range, the three major types of plant pigments, chlorophylls, carotenoids, and xanthophylls, absorb specific wavelengths and are involved in photosynthesis. The light range in which a green leaf absorbs light in the visible spectrum is in the blue, approximately 430 nanometers, and red, approximately 660 nanometer regions. The green leaf absorbs light the poorest in the green region, approximately 540 nanometers of the spectrum, thereby reflecting mostly green light and making the leaf look green to the naked eye. Light quality helps determine the height of a plant. For example, red-yellow light promotes elongation, whereas green-blue light inhibits elongation and promotes shorter plants. When supplying supplemental light, you must know the plant's requirement for light quality and quantity because of the wide variety of light sources available. Photoperiod is the length of the dark period that influences plant growth. The plant photoperiod changes on a seasonal basis. In the fall, photoperiods are shortened, and in the spring, they become longer. Plants can be divided into three groups based on their photoperiod: short day, long day, and day neutral. Short day plants, such as poinsettias, are plants that flower only when the dark period is greater than a certain critical length, because plants measure the length of the dark period in order to flower. Long day plants, such as carnations, only flower when the dark period is shorter than a certain critical length. Day neutral plants, such as roses, determine flower initiation solely by the genotype and have no specific light requirement. Any interruption in the photoperiod of long or short day plants can keep them or induce them into a flowering or vegetative state. This is often used in greenhouses to trick plants into doing what the grower wants. Temperature is important for all physiological processes in plants. It determines when and where a given type of plant can be grown. Prior to planting, you should know the temperature extremes in your particular location. The U.S. Department of Agriculture, USDA, plant hardiness map shows regions of the United States where plants can and cannot be grown. This map gives the range of average annual minimum temperatures for 11 zones throughout the United States. Although an excellent starting point for deciding what plants can be planted in your area, this should not be your only source of information. Look at the map. What zone are you in? In Central Florida, we are in Zone 9B, so that means plants rated up to Zone 9B can typically survive the winters, down to 25 to 30 degrees Fahrenheit. On this rosemary plant tag, you can see that is rated from hardiness zone 6B to 9. If you had a plant rated for, say, zones 2 to 6, it wouldn't get too cold in a state such as Florida, but it would get too hot. If a plant was rated as zone 10 to 11, you could plant it in Central Florida, but a cold winter could possibly kill it, even with frost protection. Plants vary in their temperature requirements. Hardy plants are less sensitive to temperature extremes, whereas tender plants cannot tolerate cool weather. Examples of hardy and tender plants are shown on the page. Damage to the plant by adverse temperatures depends on the physiological state of the plant. For example, actively growing succulent plants with flower buds are more susceptible to frost damage than those in a dormant state. To improve the chances of survival of both hardy and tender plants, the plant should be hardened off or gradually subjected to cooler temperatures with less frequent watering. The main components of air are nitrogen, oxygen, and carbon dioxide. For normal physiological processes to occur in the plant, such as respiration, oxygen is required. Carbon dioxide is required for photosynthesis. When either oxygen or carbon dioxide is limited, plant growth is adversely affected. Another important factor of the air is to hold water. The water content of the air is called humidity. A psychrometer is an instrument used to measure the relative humidity. Relative humidity is the ratio of the weight of water vapor in a given quantity of air to the total weight of water vapor that a quantity of air can hold at a given temperature, expressed as a percentage. Too little or too much humidity can cause problems to the plant. Therefore, it is carefully monitored for plants grown in greenhouses. Good air quality is important to maximize plant growth. Environmental pollutants are becoming a major problem, especially in heavily populated or high industry areas. Pollutants that cause significant reductions in plant growth and development are ozone and sulfur dioxide, plus a variety of pesticides, heavy metals, and others. Ozone is the most abundant in urban environments. It causes stomates to close with limited gas exchange. The symptoms show as stippling and bronzing. Sulfur dioxide is released into the atmosphere by burning coal. It enters the stomata, causing the cells to shrink and collapse. It causes bleached or pigmented necrotic intervenal areas on broadleaf plants and brown tips on needles of conifers. Water is the most important requirement for plant growth. Water in the atmosphere comes from precipitation and evaporation. Plants use water for all biochemical and physiological processes. Water is required for photosynthesis and normal growth of the plant. When water is limited, photosynthesis is reduced, which leads to a reduction in plant growth and normal development. The plant cools itself during hot weather via transpiration, which is the loss of water from the plant through the leaves in the form of vapor. Nutrients and organic compounds are transported throughout the plant in water. At water deficits, this transport is dramatically reduced. Water keeps cells turgid, which means plant cells are full of water. Water stress occurs when a plant is unable to absorb an adequate amount of water to replace that lost by transpiration. When plants lose turgidity, they wilt. Each time the plant wilts, its overall potential yield is decreased. Excessive water also kills the plant because oxygen in the roots is reduced. Environmental pollutants cause many problems in agriculture. Pesticides and nutrients are pollutants that cause significant reductions in plant growth and development. Acid rain is caused when sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxide react with water in the atmosphere to form sulfuric acid and nitric acid, which reduces the pH of rain from a normal pH 6 to as low as 4. The reduction in pH adversely affects the environment in a variety of ways. For example, acidified lakes show dramatically reduced fish populations. Acidification of the soil caused by acid rain alters nutrient availability. This leads to a variety of problems that reduce crop yields. Wind is air in motion, which can be beneficial or harmful. Wind cools the plant when temperatures are high and reduces moisture on the plant and soil surfaces, which reduces disease problems. Wind also makes the plant shorter with a tougher cuticle, which is an impermeable waxy material on the outside layer of leaves and stems that prevent water loss. By shortening the plant and making a tougher cuticle layer, the plant is more resistant to mechanical stress, pathogen, a disease-causing organism, or insect attack. Although wind can be beneficial, it can also cause critical problems. Some of the benefits of wind can also be detriments. For example, shorter plants with smaller leaves yield significantly less than normal-sized plants. Excessive wind can also cause desiccation, which accelerates the senescence process, leading to premature death. In addition, excessive wind can result in physical damage to the plant as a result of shear force. Wind can also spread fungal spores, weed seeds, pollutants, salt, and other pests. Biotic factors are living organisms ranging from animals and other plants, weeds, to microorganisms that affect the atmospheric environment. More specifically, biotic factors can be insects and related pests, nematodes, diseases such as viruses, fungi, and bacteria, weeds, rodents, and other animals. Climate affects the biotic factors. In turn, the biotic factors affect the biotic atmospheric environment. For any plant pest to become a problem, it must have a favorable environment. Both environmental and mechanical stress can adversely affect the biotic atmospheric environment by causing wear, which is the physical deterioration of a plant community resulting from excessive stress. Wear can come from a variety of sources in nature, including people, wind, and precipitation. These stresses disrupt the normal atmospheric environment surrounding the plant, resulting in a reduction in normal growth and development. Plant selection refers to selecting species that are tolerant to specific environmental stresses, thereby enabling the plant to withstand an adverse biotic atmospheric environment. Plants are being genetically engineered to make them more resistant to wear. In conclusion, abiotic atmospheric environmental factors, including temperature, moisture, light, and wind, together with biotic factors, affect plant growth and development significantly.